G'day everyone and welcome to a Royal Randwick Racecourse. The Autumn Carnival continues here at Randwick. The fourth day of the carnival, the final day of the carnival, and what a day it's going to be. It's honouring that horse on screen, and that was Ty the Knot. What a wonderful horse he has been over the years. In excess of $6 million worth of prize money. People could pose for photos with him today, and they thoroughly enjoyed it. Well, we've got some ripper races coming your way today on the Wide World of Sports, and with me, of course, as per usual, the turf team, Kenny and Ronnie. Fellas, another ripper day ahead.
Yeah, great day. I think this race is an absolutely super race. Is Victory Vane the best two-year-old in Australia, or will the 1,600 metres find her out? Pillaging will be hard to beat, but I think Chasseur might beat them all, and I reckon I've got a little mate who thinks the same way.
Yeah, I thought everyone had dropped off him, but I'm going to give him another chance. He hasn't been mentally right, or physically right, I'd suggest, but today, the whisper is he's in order.
OK, let's have a look at the two races we're going to be bringing to you today, and they are the Moulton Shandon Champagne Stakes. That'll be at 3:10pm, just around the corner. And at 3:50, the big one, the Schweppes Sydney Cup. One scratching out of the Champagne, that's Planchette, and Bondi Iceberg comes out of the Sydney Cup. Well, the first race we're going to show you is the Champagne Stakes. Let's take a look at the totes, Ken.
Okay, number one, Pillaging, is at 5.60. That will firm. He's considerably shorter in the ring now. Chasseur at $3. Planchette, as Simon told you, is a scratching. Half Hennessy at $10. Redwood Falls at 17. The favourite, Victory Vane, the filly, is at 2.10. And the other filly in the race, the Fernhill Handicap winner, Salomar, is at $22.
Well, the two-year-olds have been in the yard. Let's take a peek at how they look. In particular, the top weight, Pillaging, come off a win from the heroic last start, Ronnie.
Oh, he's rock hard fit. He's a marauding and it's a mile. That's the only concern I've got, but he's lovely and relaxed there, and he's in top form. He's missed a lot of the hard racing and he's been set for this and well tried in the ring, as Ken said.
I think a horse you could probably consider a touch unlucky this preparation has been number two, and that's Schwarzer Pillaging still with us there, and you're quite right, Ronnie. Looks rock hard and ready to go. Well, number two in this race is trained by Paul Perry. That's Schwarzer, Ken.
Yeah, look, circumstances, riding tactics, greenness, they've all beaten him in the Pago, the Slipper and the Size Produce. I really think he'll stand up today, and looking at him, I'm so pleased. It doesn't look as though the hard, tough runs have hurt him.
Yeah, a horse. I remember around Golden Slipper Day, they were saying there could have been some problems with the shins and he jarred up a little bit, but I tell you, he's raced all right since then.
Yeah, he certainly has. Now, the shoes that he's wearing are proper shoes today, not them padded shoes. Now, look at this filly here. She's the opposite to Schwarzer. She just does everything right. She can make two runs in a race. She relaxes. She helps herself, Victory Vane. Just look at her there. She's just done a fantastic job. Second in the Slipper, the winner of the Size Produce. And if she wins today, she's obviously two-year-old of the year.
That filly looks spot on, Kenny.
Yeah, my word. Look, she's not a big, strong filly by any means, but she looks as good now as she did three runs back, don't you think, Ron?
No, there's no doubt about that. She's just the ultimate professional.
Yeah, she certainly is the ultimate professional. And another horse that, well, I think we could say is the ultimate professional is Schwarzer. His trainer is Paul Perry. Here he is with Andrew Voss.
Paul, third in the Slipper, second in the Size Produce. If the sequence follows, this is going to be a big day.
Yeah, well, hopefully. You know, he's nice to himself, the horse, you know, and he's drawn well, and Paddy Payne should ride him well, hopefully, so...
Many said Swazir beat himself in the Size Produce. Was that your assessment?
I'd say that, yeah. Look, he drew wide and had no cover early, and they went slow, and next minute he was over racing with his head in the air, and he more or less had to ride him that way to settle, you know. But I'm sure if they run along a little bit, which you think they would, you know, once he gets a bit of cover, he's all right, you know, he settles well.
Well, where do you expect Victory Vane to be in running? Came from last to first last start. And where do you want Swazir?
Look, I reckon it's hard to say what they'll do with her. You know, like, it was a bit unexpected the other day. She got back when she's always raced forward. But, you know, if our horse just had a tuck away, he could be anywhere. You know, long as he had a tuck away and be behind something, he'll, as long as he settles well, he's right, I reckon, you know.
All the best, Paul.
Good. Thanks very much.
Yeah, pretty confident Paul Perry there. I wonder if our tipsters are confident. Kenny's gone with Schwarzer, Victory Vane, Half Hennessy. Ronnie's gone with Schwarzer, Victory Vane, and Redwood Falls. We're going to take a break from Royal Randwick and we'll be back then with the Champagne Stakes.
Thank you.
plenty of colour here at Royal Randwick, and there has been right throughout this autumn carnival. The weather has been perfect, and today is no exception. The Champagne Stakes, the Sydney Cup, the Champagne Stakes just around the corner. And by gee, people have had a wonderful time right throughout this autumn carnival, and it's going to continue today. Let's have a quick look at the totes before they jump in the Champagne Stakes.
Yeah, Pillaging has come in a touch already to 4.40, might come in a touch more yet. 3.30, Chazur. Planchette is out. Half Hennessy at 7.40, $19 for Redwood Falls. $2.40 now the favourite, Victory Vane. That's about 11 to 8 in the old language, and $20 the other filly, Salomar.
Yes, the two-year-olds have made their way over to the 1,600-metre start here at Randwick. What a famous mile start it is. One of the most famous in Australia. Ronnie, just in the commercial break, you mentioned the five, Redwood Falls, you thought was well overs.
Well, he's 50-1 on track. I think that's way over the odds. I thought his win in the Bailey was outstanding. He was a late scratching in the size when he reared up in the barrier, but Clary's given him a hard trial since, where he's demoralised his opposition, and he gives the impression he'll run a mile. I wouldn't leave him out of your trifectas here.
Ron, I expect Salomar to lead. Agree with that?
Oh, yeah, I think she's a running type of filly. Just interesting to see what Danny Beasley does from the outside barrier.
That's the $50,000 question. Will he go forward and be outside Salomar, or will he drop back like he did last week?
I think if he does go forward, Oliver will make him work that little bit so he gets the 1-1. So, interesting. This is a real little tactical race with only the six runners.
Okay, well, they're just about to go into the barrier now, as you can see them over behind at the start, and it's going to be an absolute thriller. This is a Group 1 race, the third of the two-year-old triple crown, following on from the Golden Slipper at Rosehill Gardens, the Size Produce Stakes here at Randwick, and now the Moet and Shandon Champagne Stakes. And to call the action, courtesy of Sky Channel, is a bright young caller, Terry Bailey.
Thank you very much, Kenny. And Duff must be on the mark, because Redwood Falls has halved his quote almost in the ring. He's been well tried. Victory Vane has blown out the gate. On track, Pillaging Schwazi are very, very well supported. Great lineup, and as Ken said, the million-dollar question, what does Danny Beasley do on Victory Vane? Does he rush her out of the gate, sit outside of Salome, or does he go back and sit her just back in the field? Now, Redwood Falls about to move in. Victory Vane's rider out of the saddle, Danny Beasley. This would certainly give her the two-year-old of the year if she could sweep this race aside. Not that she's already not a hot contender for the title. Pillaging, the winner of the Heroic and Half Hennessy, in a rematch up. Now, Redwood Falls in a bit of a cranky mood. Late scratching in the sires has been led up. Lovely colt by Woodman. He's about to move in. Glenn Boss in the saddle. He'll ride Shogun Lodge later in the Queen Elizabeth. And here's this marvellous little filly, Victory Vane, moving up. Pillaging heavily supported on track. Victory Vane the favourite, 2.40 the tote. Pillaging 4.30, Schwazi at 3.20. Further support, Redwood Falls. He's been the medium of good support at long odds, more than halving his opening quote. The Moet and Shandon Champagne Stakes. Final leg of the Sydney Triple Crown. Lights are on. They're ready to jump. Racing. Half Hennessy fast away near the inside. Salome stoked up early going for the front. Pillaging began well, going back as Redwood Falls. Schwazi is second last on the fence. Well, Beasley's out deep on Victory Vane. What's he going to do? Is he going to go forward or is he going to stay back? Salome in front of Pillaging after about 400 metres. Victory Vane's out wide. She's going up three deep. Half Hennessy, the stablemate, the fence. Schwazi now one from the rail. Second last and 2.5 to Redwood Falls. He's taken off on Victory Vane, coming off the back, 1,000 metres to go. And the little glamour filly race clear by two lengths on Pillaging. Salome relegated back to third. Two lengths, Schwazi settling a lot better in the run today. Then came Half Hennessy and 2.5 to Redwood Falls. Down the side. Foot on the brake is Danny Beasley on Victory Vane. 800 metres to go in the Champagne. Leading by three quarters on the Victorian Pillaging. A length and a half away, Salome from Schwazier, only three from the speed. Then Half Hennessy and Redwood Falls last in the field of six with 600 metres to go. Victory Vane leads coming to the corner by a neck on Pillaging, about to up the tempo to the leader. Salome behind them, Schwazier yet to come out. Redwood Falls hooks wide. Half Hennessy last as they turn the corner. Victory Vane in front. Pillaging's drawn alongside of the filly. Schwazier is being let down and he's really starting to motor, and Redwood Falls is coming after him. Victory Vane taken on by Schwazier. Schwazier's hit the lead. Victory Vane's not going to give up without a fight. She's got courage. Victory Vane and Schwazier. Half Hennessy coming late. Victory Vane repels the challenge. Beats Babes in front. Half Hennessy comes at Victory Vane. Oh, great performance Victory Veins won the champagne. Half Hennessy second, a beat Murray Quinella. Third is Schwarzier from Pillaging, Redwood Falls, and Salome last in.
Well, all I can tell you is nothing could possibly have an excuse. Because of the tactics, Beasley was forced to go early on Victory Vane. But when the whips were cracking, she was there. Chazur joined her. She fought him off and beat him fairly and squarely. Victory Vane, 250 and 150. Half Hennessy is at 280. We've got a bad... 280 it is indeed. And Chazur third, number two, no third dividends. The numbers are 6, 4 and 2. Victory Vane, Half Hennessy and Chazur. As they come into the straight... Victory Vane leads from Pillaging. He couldn't run the mile. Outside of him is Chazur. At this stage, Payne's got a grip on him. He races up the rise, races up to Victory Vane, and I wanted to double my bet. But silly me, because at this point, Beasley said, let's go, girl, on Victory Vane. She fought off the challenge of the big Newcastle colt, and from here home, the filly on the rails was far too good. Coming late is Half Hennessy, coincidentally a stablemate of Victory Vane, and he made a real race of it over the last 60 or 70 metres, but she held him off, and Victory Vane first, Half Hennessy second, Chazur third. Here again, it's Victory Vane from Pillaging, Chazur joining in the light blue cap. They're the only three you can really see on screen at the moment. You'll see Half Hennessy come late. Payne hasn't gone for the whip yet, and Chazur has joined Victory Vane. But then again, neither had Beasley, and Victory Vane found much more over the final 200 metres and left the colt with no excuses. Ron, no excuses.
Oh, no way. She's outstanding, Victory Vane, and there was no betting coming up the rise. It was Schwarzier, but she was just too good. Full credit to Bede Murray, a Quinella in a Group 1.
Yeah, he deserves it, Bede. He's had shocking luck, Universal, well, not shocking luck, but things have not quite gone his way. With Universal Prince just getting run down by Ethereal in the BMW, this filly, Victory Vane, being quite unlucky in the Golden Slipper, and then in the English Classic here, Pillaging beat his horse, Half Hennessy, in rather controversial circumstances. But then he won the Group 1 with Victory Vane and the sires, and he doubled up Group 1s today with the Quinella, actually, Victory Vane and Half Hennessy. Young Danny Beasley is excited. Here's Andrew Voss.
Yeah, Ken, I'm with Bede Murray right now. Well, hard luck stories, close calls the last 6 months, but today the Quinella in a Group 1.
Can't get any better than that, can it?
And what about the courage shown by Victory Vane?
Oh, great courage. You know, she's done it both ends again, and... probably just shows how unlucky she probably was in the slipper.
Last to first in the sires today, leading round the turn. Was that the plan?
It was left to Danny, how the race worked out, you know, and I always said it'd be a tactical race, and he's pulled the right rein.
And Half Hennessy, plenty of talent there as well.
Yeah, great run by him as well.
Well done, Bede, fantastic.
It certainly was fantastic, and there he is, Danny Beasley, coming back on a wonderful filly. A heart as big as Farlap. She's taken all before her this campaign, deservedly. Winning this Group 1 race here today to finish off the Autumn Carnival for the two-year-olds. As we take a break on the wide world of sports from Royal Randwick.
Here comes Republic, last cutting leash. Oh, she's come with a blinding burst. Went straight past Elegant Fashion Keys. 60 seconds, Demoscino, but Republic last. Elegant Fashion.
Bossy, well, you can wave your whip with confidence today, boy.
Danny Beasley coming back to scale on Victory Vane, and have a look at this. You thought Darren Beaver was the only man that could do it. Danny Beasley can do it. Why wouldn't he be happy? So he should be. Kenny, let's have a look at the dibs.
Yeah, number six, Victory Vane, the two-year-old of the year, certainly will get that prize when it's presented at the Crown Casino in Melbourne later in the year. 250 and 150. Half Hennessy second paid 280, and there was no third dividend for Chazur. The Super Tab, Uni Tab prices are there, as well as your Quinellas, Exactas and Trifectas.
Well, you just saw the winning jockey do the star jump. He also had a yarn with Andrew Voss straight after the race. Here he is.
Well, Denny, what about that? A star jump to finish, something you've been working on?
Yeah, I had a go last week, and it was a pretty ordinary effort, but this week I mastered it not too bad.
This is what all the hard work's for, a Group 1 win at Randwick.
These are the special times, and it's just great to be associated with such a special filly like you. Every jockey dreams of just coming a long one in their career, and, geez, I've come a long one, and the ride's been terrific, and hopefully we're still going around.
Well, Danny, didn't she show some ticker today?
Oh, that's one thing about her. She's just a... you can do, like, I've rode her from first to last to back. Every time, she must think, what about this bloke? Every time he rides me, he does something different on me. But she just, you push, you do something, and she just answers. She's just a freak.
Well done, Danny.
Yeah, happy Danny Boosie. He's got quite an affiliation with that filly, and just having a look at that ride today, Pillaging came at him, Schlosser came at him, not at any stage did he panic. He understood what amount of horse he had underneath him.
Yeah, I knew that he hadn't fully gone for her when Chasseur come, but like she'd had to do the work early in the race, and Chasseur had been saved, Patrick Payne just still cuddling him. I thought he'd go Wishka. Ronnie Duffesy was in my ear, and we were both on Chasseur. He said, 3 lengths, mate. But it wasn't that way. She just kept fighting back.
Well, that was the second good front-running ride we've seen today. The other one was in the Frank Packer Plate, which was here at Randwick earlier this afternoon. Take a look at this. Arlington Road, never headed, Kenny.
Against the fence. This was a sensational win. They actually broke 60 seconds for the first 1,000 metres. I thought he'd fall in a hole, and he kept going. He's now going to Queensland for the Derby. And look, the Packer Plate's been a super race. And incidentally, that's Mrs. Val Smith on the left being presented the trophy by Lady Packer on the right, the Frank Packer Plate. And Sir Frank Packer, of course, was an AJC committeeman, as well as owning newspapers and television stations. And I think, like other Frank Packer Plate winners, like Juggler and Might and Power, that horse will go on to something better.
Yes, you would think so. Very impressive today in the Frank Packer Plate was Arlington Road. Now, the Sydney Cup's the next one. It's just around the corner. Let's have a look at the early totes leading in.
Yeah, Dress Circle, $9.40. Hail, $10. $25 for Spirit of Westbury. $28 for Karazi. Then Mr. Prude at $33. $15 Ebony Honor. $7.30 Soldier Blue. Well, in the market. Asia at $10. Over the page we go to TAB number 9, Henderson Blue, Henderson Bay, I should say, at $5.30. $20 for Armstrong. Bondi Icebergs are scratching. Conair at $92. Home Wrecker at $18. $1.93 for Meet the Stars. Mr. Nelson from the Waterhouse Stable at $21. Royal Treen at $112. Number 17 is Cavallo Bruno, already a 3,200 metre winner at $15. Lottery prize, John Wheeler from New Zealand, $25. Plea at $168. Pentastic, the three-year-old, has longer odds than he has been during the week, $11 on the tote. And Star of the Seas, Chris Munster, ride him now, or her, I should say, at $76.
Well, not easy to find a winner of any 3,200 metre race in this country or in the world. But this week we sent out our investigating man, and that was Kenny Callender, of course, to talk to a few of the trainers. Here's what they had to say.
David Hall, you're in the fortunate position of having two runners in the Sydney Cup, Pentastic and Karasi. Pentastic, the better chance?
Yeah, look, I suppose so. Everyone wants to talk about the three-year-old taking on the older horses, and his form's excellent, Kenny. So, always a bit of a query at the 2 mile for the first time. And, you know, his aim was the Derby, so we've got to get another run out of him. But he's pleased me this week you know, looking forward to it.
What have you done with him in the 2 weeks since the Derby?
Well, he had an easy few days after the Derby. You know, I think the horse, that was his goal, and he's very fit. I don't think you could sort of train him to run 2 miles now. It's just a matter of whether he's actually going to have the stamina to do it or not. So he's had a couple of light gallops on the course proper this week, just on his own, and Brett's been quite pleased with him.
Now, what about Karasi? He's got a bit of 2 mile form.
He's got excellent 2 mile form. You know, he's had 4 runs, running second in Adelaide, 2/3 in the Brisbane Cup, and 4th in the Melbourne Cup, which was quite exciting last year. So his form the last couple of runs is not quite as good. Had a little bit of trouble with his feet, Kenny, and we've changed his shoes around this week. He worked quite nicely Tuesday morning and pulled up comfortable afterwards. So, you know, we're pressing on and running him, and if he gets back to his right form, he could certainly be a threat in the race.
Bruce Marsh, 18 Alley, is that a problem for Hale?
It's not an advantage, that's for sure. Yeah, I was looking forward to seeing the draws, and I was a bit despondent once we saw them. But
you have to go forward from there?
Definitely go forward, yeah. I could see him sitting up probably about fifth in the running, you know, slot one off the fence.
Nice spot. What about the weights going up 3.5 kilograms? You're a bit of a critic of that.
Very, very disappointed as far as my horse is concerned. He's only a four-year-old. We looked at running, you know, first start over 2 mile with 53 kilos, jumps up to 56.5. That's a good horse's weight. Plus the fact that he carries another kilo with the vest allowance, so that's 57.5. I think it's a big ask.
Now, in the Chairman's Handicap, the horse was sensationally backed, but he had absolutely no luck in the straight. He was hemmed in and nowhere to go.
No luck at all in the straight. And there was, I think, no question that the horse had a lot up his sleeve going to the line, and, yeah, just got no daylight.
How's he done since?
Well, he's done exceptionally well, actually. I weren't going to run him in the cup. I thought he was just a little bit early on him, but taking in all the fact that run, being so unlucky, Jimmy's comments after the race, he said, don't go home, you'll win the cup, and taking of his advice, hope he's right.
Roy Stowling, a few of the other Kiwi trainers seem to think that Soldier Blue's the horse that might have beat the handicapper.
Well, you're probably right. Yeah, he's got under his guard, no doubt, you know. But I suppose I'll be happy about that after Melbourne.
Well, you had 59.5 when you were in second in the Duke of Norfolk.
Yeah, he had a fair bit to carry, but he couldn't himself well. So, yeah, take the good with the bad. Turned out all right.
And how's the horse done since he came to Sydney?
I'm more than happy with him. He arrived in good shape and he's well. Worked nice this morning. Can't complain at all.
And he's a dead set 2-miler.
He will go 2 miles, there's no doubt about it. Yeah, no worries at all about his distance. He'll handle it, no trouble. Big tough bugger.
Well, I hope that helps you sort out the winner of the Sydney Cup. That's not too far away as we take a break on Royal Randwick.
Why would you come out and see a horse like this get saddled up?
Because Tyrone's a champion.
Before he even arrived here, you know, you were looking forward to getting him. And then once he started to show speed, we thought, hello, what have we got here?
Brave Princess raced to the lead in the Spring Champion Stakes. Tie the Knot is out after him now in the red with the white cap. Brave Prince in front, Tie the Knot knuckling down, is charging. Tie the Knot is going a shade the better, and Tie the Knot! Tie the Knot got up to win the Spring Champion Stakes in a thrilling. Hall goes for the whip on Doremus, the lightly weighted. Tie the Knot is coming at him strongly. Doremus and Tie the Knot. Tie the Knot on the outside takes a narrow lead over Doremus as they get near home, and with a huge pull in the weights, Tie the Knot will fall in. Tie the Knot by a neck to Doremus, gallant in the lead. Tie the Knot in front, Dye's riding supremely confident, his hands and heels, Itter goes under the back coming after him, Tie the Knot in front responds, he's too good, he's back with a big win, Tie the Knot goes home and wins the Mercedes. Arena's levelled up with Showella, Tie the Knot starting to come the rail, Arena in front, Tie the Knot's getting up on the inside and Showella stride for stride, the champion, Tie the Knot bursting up on the fence, Dye does it again, Tie the Knot wins his second Mercedes Classic from Steel Hill of Grace in front. Referral trying to gun him down. Tie the Knot responds. Like the great champion he is, he looms up. He grabs the lead from Referral, Hill of Grace and Giovanna. And the multi-millionaire races home with another round bet. Tie the Knot, a great winner. But here's Tie the Knot. He's lengthening stride. He's coming with great guns at the 150. And Tie the Knot raced away. Universal Prince late. But Tie the Knot, the grand old campaigner. He makes racing history. Four successive Chipping Norton Stakes.
Wow, what a horse, Tie the Knot. In excess of $6 million worth of prize money. The AJC are honouring him here today. And, well, Kenny, have you seen... He's got to be in the top half dozen horses in the last 20 years.
Yeah, he's a sensational horse, Tie the Knot. Like, the fact that he could win the same Group 1 race at 1,600 metres against all comers 4 years in a row.
One of the best you've seen, Ronnie?
Oh, he's just one of them tried and true performers that kept backing up year in, year out, and he really put Guy Walter on the map, and I don't think anything will ever replace Tie the Knot in Guy Walter's heart.
That's exactly right, and like Guy's training winners left, right and centre now, including the Oaks winner last week, but Republic Last, but oh, gee whiz, Tie the Knot, he's something else.
Well, I reckon he'll have butterflies because Tie the Knot is going to do an exhibition gallop here at the up the straight at Randwick. I wonder how he does feel, the trainer of Tie the Knot, retired last week. That's Guy Walter, of course, and here he is with Andrew Voss.
Yeah, thank you, Simon, with Guy Walter. Well, for all our viewers watching on the wide world of sports, put them in your shoes. How are you feeling right now?
Well, Andrew, I suppose it's inevitable. His career's got to come to an end. He's almost 8 years old. But I'm Yeah, I would say that I'm extremely proud to have been associated with him, and as I've said many times, I feel it's been a privilege to be his trainer. He's a great horse. He could never be replaced, and he's given all of us so many thrills.
Guy, 13 Group 1 victories. Can you single out one? Is that possible? Is that too hard a question?
Well, it is very difficult. I thought when he ran in the Chipping Norton Stakes, when he ran four in a row, that was one of his highlights. When he ran the Mercedes Classic at Rose Hill in a thrilling finish, that was a great day as well.
And I'll let you watch Ty the Knot run down past the finishing post, because this is one moment you don't want to miss. Paddy Payne gets it past the winning post. Let's chalk up another victory. Where to now for Ty the Knot? Being a gelding, what's ahead?
Well, he's going to be retired to Sandy Tate's property at Gundagai. And initially, he's going to have a long rest, and hopefully he never has to leave the property. But retirement may not agree with him, Andrew. He may get too fat. And we'll just see what he has to do, see how he goes. Sandy will make that decision. But initially, he's going to have a long rest.
All right, Guy. Well, congratulations for your part in this marvellous galloper, a real champion.
Thanks very much, Andrew.
Thanks, Guy.
Yes, he certainly was a great champion, Ty the Knot, and wonderful to be here on a day when they honoured him. A great round of applause as he came up the straight here at Randwick, and I think there'll be a round of applause shortly as they come up the straight at Randwick, thundering up the straight in the Sydney Cup as we take a break from the Autumn Carnival. Welcome back to Royal Randwick, and the runners are in the mounting yard for the Schweppes Sydney Cup over the 3,200 metres. Let's get straight into the parade, and number one, Kenny Dresscircle.
Yeah, Gay Waterhouse trained stayer. She just kept him right up to it with a run in the 1,600 metre race behind Sunline here last week, and he rattled home to run third. He won the Metrop over 2,400. He looks a treat. He'll run a race.
And number two is Hale. What do you think, Ron?
Yeah, well, this is the horse that had no luck in the chairman's handicap when he was backed off the map that day.